Our first scripture this morning comes from Paul's letter to the Colossians, chapter 4, verse 2 through 6. Pray diligently. Stay alert with your eyes wide open in gratitude. Don't forget to pray for us, that God will open doors for telling the mystery of Christ, even while I'm locked up in this jail. Pray that every time I open my mouth, I'll be able to make Christ plain as day to them. Use your heads as you live and work among outsiders. Make the most of every opportunity. Be gracious in your speech. The goal is to bring out the best in others in a conversation, not put them down or cut them out. And our gospel lesson comes from the Gospel of Matthew, chapter 5, verses 38 through 45. Jesus says, "You have heard that it was said, an eye for an eye, and a tooth for a tooth. But I say to you that you must not oppose those who want to hurt you. If people slap you on your right cheek, turn the left cheek to them as well. When they wish to haul you to court and take your shirt, let them have your coat too. When they force you to go 1 mile, go with them too. Give to those who ask. Don't refuse those who wish to borrow from you. You have heard that it was said, you must love your neighbor and hate your enemy. But I say to you, love your enemies and pray for those who harass you so that you will be acting as children of your Father who is in heaven." For the word of God in Scripture, for the word of God among us, and for the word of God within us, we say, thanks be to God.
To walk humbly with
books? No? It's called The Tale of Three Trees. And usually, this just came to me last night, so I apologize the pictures aren't on the screens, but you can imagine it well. This is an old traditional folklore. Once upon a mountaintop, three little trees stood and dreamed of what they wanted to become when they grew up. The first little tree looked up at the stars twinkling like diamonds above. "I want to hold treasure," the tree said. "I want to be covered with gold and filled with precious stones. I will be the most beautiful treasure chest in the world." The second little tree looked out at the small stream trickling by on its way to the ocean. "I want to be a strong sailing ship. I want to travel mighty waters and carry powerful kings. I will be the strongest ship in the world."
What's that ship?
A big boat. The third little tree looked down into the valley below where busy men and busy women worked in a busy town. "I don't want to leave this mountaintop at all."
What's a busy town?
"I want to grow so tall that when people stop to look at me, they will raise their eyes to heaven and think of God. I will be the tallest tree in the world." Years passed, but how big they are. The rains came, the sun shone, and the little trees grew tall. Yeah. One day, three woodcutters climbed the mountain. The first woodcutter looked at the first tree and said, "This tree is beautiful. It's perfect for me." With a swoop of his shining axe, the first tree fell. "Now I'll be made into a beautiful chest," thought the first tree. "I will hold wonderful treasure." The second woodcutter looked at the second tree and said, "This tree is strong. It is perfect for me." With a swoop of his shining axe, the second tree fell. "Now I will sail mighty waters," thought the second tree. "I'll be a strong ship fit for kings." The third tree felt her heart sink when the last woodcutter looked her way. She stood straight and tall and pointed bravely to heaven, but the woodcutter never even looked up. "Any kind of tree will do for me," he muttered. With a swoop of his shining axe, the third tree fell. The first tree rejoiced when the woodcutter brought him to a carpenter's shop, but the busy carpenter was not thinking about treasure chests. Instead, his wood-worn hands fashioned the tree into a feed box for animals. The once beautiful tree was not covered with gold or filled with treasure. He was coated with sawdust and filled with hay for hungry farm animals to eat. Then the second tree smiled when the woodcutter took him to a shipyard. But no mighty sailing ships were being made that day. Instead, the once strong tree was hammered and sawed into a simple fishing boat, too small and too weak to sail an ocean or even a river. He was taken to a little lake. Every day, he brought in loads of dead, smelly fish. The third tree was confused when the woodcutter cut her into strong beams and left her in a lumber yard. "What happened?" the once tall tree wondered. "All I ever wanted to do was stay on the mountaintop and point to God." Many, many days and nights passed. The three trees nearly forgot their dreams. But one night, golden starlight poured over the first tree as a young woman placed her newborn baby in the feed box. I wish I could make a cradle for him, her husband whispered. The mother squeezed his hand and smiled as the starlight shone on the smooth and sturdy wood. This manger is beautiful, she said. And suddenly, the first tree knew he was holding the greatest treasure in the world. One evening, a long time after that, a tired traveler and his friends crowded into the old fishing boat. The traveler fell asleep as the second tree quietly sailed out into the lake. Soon, a thundering and thrashing storm arose. The little tree shuddered. He knew he did not have the strength to carry so many passengers safely through the wind and rain. The tired man awakened. He stood up, stretched out his hands, and said, "Peace." The storm stopped as quickly as it had begun, and suddenly the second tree knew he was carrying the King of heaven and earth. One Friday morning, a while after that, the third tree was startled when her beams were yanked from the forgotten wood pile. She flinched as she was carried through an angry, jeering crowd. She shuddered when soldiers nailed a man's hands to her. She felt ugly and harsh and cruel. But on Sunday morning, when the sun rose and the earth trembled with joy beneath her, the third tree knew that God's love had changed everything. It had made the first tree beautiful. It had made the second tree strong. And every time people thought of the third tree, they would think of God. That was better than being the tallest tree in the world. So that's the story of three trees and who got to meet all of those three trees. Jesus, that's right. They each had a part to play in Jesus' life. And their whole beings, the whole tree, was used as a symbol and as a gift to Jesus, right? And even when they didn't get what they wanted to be, right? The first tree wanted to be a treasure box and a big ship and the tallest tree on the hillside. They didn't get to be that. But what they did end up becoming was even more important to Jesus' story, right? The cradle that held him, the boat that he was in when he calmed the storm, and of course the cross. Which even at first the cross didn't seem very like a good thing to be, right? But now, like she said, every time people see a cross, we think of God. And so that's what we're working on now as we continue to celebrate that Jesus is alive, that he came back from the dead, and will lead us into everlasting life. That we want our whole lives, our whole being, even if it doesn't turn out like we hope and dream it turns out, we know that God will still use our whole lives as a gift to Jesus. So that's what we want. We want to be like these three trees. And it's good that we have hopes and dreams, that we can do great things with our whole selves. And sometimes those will happen and sometimes they won't. But no matter what we end up becoming when we grow up, we know that God can use us in this big story of Jesus, because the story keeps going, right? We're still the church that Jesus says he needs in the world. We're Jesus' hands and feet now. So God will certainly use us in our lives. So remember that this week as things work out or when they don't work out. That no matter what happens to our plans, God has a plan and can use us. Sound good? Yeah. All right, let's pray. God, we thank you for the great gift of Jesus and that you trust us now to be his hands and feet in the world, to do his work. We pray that no matter what we might plan or whatever happens to us, as we grow, you would use us to tell the world how much you love them, how much you love all of us. And so we pray your blessing on these children, that you would keep them safe this week and bring them back next week to learn more about you. And all of God's children said,
amen.
Our stewardship minute this morning is more of an announcement and a joy, a celebration, that on Thursday this week, our so-and-so's group is being honored as Volunteer of the Year by the Broome County Council of Churches. Such a great honor to be recognized for the work that they have done in our community and in the county, and it's wonderful that they're welcoming 14 of us all, you all the so-and-sos, to go down early Thursday morning so you can be in prayer that we make it on time for breakfast at the Doubletree, where they will honor the so-and-sos and share a video story of the work and the mission, the ministry of that group. And so we just rejoice in that blessing and know that, you know, this will bring even more attention to it and continue to help it grow and spread. A lot of the ladies who will be going are not even members of the church, but people from the community, other churches that have joined them on Thursdays or Tuesdays that will be heading down. So we just pray that this ecumenical mission ministry will keep spreading to other churches and growing, and that we always get that next load of fabric just when we need it. So that will certainly be a blessing to keep spreading the word and to celebrate. So just give thanks to God this week for the so-and-sos and for all that God has continued to do in providing for that ministry. I'd ask you now to please pray for me as I pray for you. Let us pray. O holy God, make your truth known to us this day and forever. For you are our rock and our Redeemer. Amen. Happy Easter, church.
Happy Easter.
That's right. We get a whole 50 days to celebrate the season of Eastertide, as it's called in the church calendar. But really, should we ever stop celebrating the resurrection? Since July, we have been focusing on walking the walk in worship, really figuring out how do we live like followers of Jesus every day. We shared some Holy Ghost stories that we've experienced. We worked on living unafraid. We gave God the gift of yes for Christmas. We looked at who's all in our family as we walk the walk together. And of course, most recently, for the season of Lent, we worked on having a CrossFit faith. And we wrapped up that Lenten series last week, recognizing we will never be done with the things that bring us spiritual health, right? We're never finished. We are meant to practice our faith as a way of life. We're meant to live resurrection lives. Our faith isn't just things we believe, it's what we do, how we live each day. So that brings us to the end of our journey of focusing on walking the walk. And I can't think of a better way to conclude this year-long focus than with this awesome little book that I hope you all have by now, surprise the world, The 5 Habits of Highly Missional People by Michael Frost. The principles and instructions in this book, I believe, are really going to help us to take our faith from a set of beliefs to a way of life, a life that testifies to God's love and grace. And we know that's what we're supposed to be doing, right? Jesus' final words, as we remembered last week, to his disciples before he ascended, were the instructions to go, preach, a change of heart and life for the forgiveness of sins in my name to all the nations. This is some good stuff we have going on here, right? This needs to be shared. It's meant to be shared. There's an old myth that I've always loved, that when Jesus got to heaven after his ascension, after his resurrection and ascension, the angels came and said, "So what's the plan, Jesus? What's next?" And he said, "Well, I told the humans, go and spread the good news." And they were like, "Yeah, but, you know, we know the humans. What's the backup plan, right? You know, what are you going to do?" And he said, "Nothing. That's it. There's no backup plan." And the angels just walked away, shaking their heads, thinking Jesus was a fool. We're it, folks. We're the only Bible some people will read, right? And I truly believe that we want to make the most of every opportunity and every relationship. We want to spread this good news. I have to believe that, or why else would you be here? When there's so many other things we could all be doing on a Sunday morning, you got up and you came to church because you're interested in better following those instructions from Jesus. But I also know that just the thought of doing evangelism will have all of us running for the door. So I've got a first bit of good news for us all. The author of this great little book we're reading says that we're not supposed to all be evangelists. Sharing our faith isn't supposed to be anxiety-producing. I think that's some really wonderful, refreshing news. And I completely agree with Reverend Frost, who says in the first chapter, when gifted evangelists tell the rest of us that we should be behaving like gifted evangelists, that just has a debilitating effect. We look at these confident, articulate, theologically trained evangelists and hear them preaching and telling us that we too need to be out there spreading the good news, and we just freeze, right? Because we know we can't do that. That's not who we are. And the book tells us it's okay. We don't have to be evangelists. Yes, evangelism is an essential activity of all churches, but it isn't a gift that every single one of us has been given. So in the scripture, we can see this is the case, even in the Bible. We read Paul, one of the greatest evangelists of all times, tells the church in Colossae to pray for him and the other evangelists that they might be bold, right? He said, pray for opportunities for me to share about our faith and have clarity when those opportunities arise. He didn't tell all the believers of that church that they should be praying for the same opportunities for themselves. So it would seem, when we look at Paul's instructions to all the churches, that he kind of has this two-pronged approach for the church, the early church, to share the faith. The first is that gifted evangelists would be in churches preaching, proclaiming the faith regularly and boldly. And the second prong is that the rest of us, he says, are called to be questionable. Right? Paul tells them, be wise when you act, as you act towards outsiders, make the most of every opportunity. Let your conversations always be full of grace, seasoned with salt, so that you may know how to answer everyone. There it is. So that you may know how to answer everyone. It seems Paul is assuming that the average believer's job is to answer questions about their lives from unbelievers. So, how many questions are we answering every week about our faith? Zero to none. I, even as a pastor, with a lot of weeks, you know, outside of Bible study, there are a lot of questions about faith from outsiders. And perhaps that's because we're not living particularly questionable lives, right? No one ever is going to ask us questions about our faith if we aren't questionable or intriguing or surprising. That's why Michael Frost calls his book Surprise the World. Because it's only when we're surprising or intriguing that anyone is going to ask us a question. If our lives look pretty much like every other respectable law-abiding citizen, that's not really very intriguing, right? And he tells us in the book, we're doing it wrong if no one ever asks us a question about why we do things we do in our life. Now, don't get feeling bad about this, okay? There's no shame or blame here. Because really, the church hasn't thought about it this way or taught us to be questionable like this, maybe since the days of Paul, at least the past 500 years. We just haven't been thinking this way. And that's why I'm so excited about this book. We were never taught to be questionable as a way for us to share our faith as the average believer. We were always told, you know, be the evangelist out there knocking on doors. Well, that doesn't work, right? That's not us. We're just called to be questionable. I can remember so clearly one day in high school, I was leaving lunch, go to class, and a friend of mine stopped me, and he just seemed so exhausted, and he just said, Corey, why are you happy? What is it? Well, you're just always okay. And you know, I knew my friend for many years. We'd gone to school together, and I knew he'd struggled with depression, even from a young age. He'd been bullied some. But I was caught completely off guard in that moment. I was not ready to be questioned because I wasn't thinking about living a questionable life. I never thought anyone would ever ask me something like that. And so, you know, I fumbled. I really felt unprepared and underwhelmed by my own response. I said, I don't know, I go to church. You know, I knew I should say something, right, about God, about my faith. I was raised going to church every Sunday. And I tried to save it. I said, you know, I guess I know that everything will be okay eventually. You know, that it will work out. And I don't know. I have to think that if I had been taught or encouraged to be living a questionable life, that at least I would have been excited about a question, right? That maybe I wouldn't have been so unprepared or thrown off. I don't know at 16 if I would have had the perfect answer, but at least I wouldn't have been caught off guard. Now, it wasn't long after that exchange that I discovered a quote from the author Madeleine L'Engle that really got me thinking about life and faith in this way. She says, live your life so strangely, it would make no sense if God didn't exist. Live your life so strangely, it would make no sense if God didn't exist. That's it. That's what it's all about. To live so oddly, so counterculturally, so surprisingly, that our very lives are proof of a living, loving God. In Surprise the World, the author talks about how the early Christians just infiltrated every part of Roman society. By devoting themselves to sacrificial acts of kindness. They loved their enemies and forgave their persecutors. They cared for the poor and fed the hungry. In the brutality of life under Roman rule, they were the most stunningly different people anyone had ever seen. The way they lived didn't make sense. They welcomed everyone, regardless of status, in a culture that was obsessed with status. They were just literally the most surprising alternative society, and it was their conduct, what they did every day, that just raised this insatiable curiosity among the Romans. They just had to know, what was it about these people that made them live so differently? They were living out Jesus' instructions that we read again. Those core principles from Jesus. And we read them this time from Matthew. As he says, love your enemies. Bless those who curse you. Give more to the people who want to take from you. Walk the extra mile. Turn the other cheek. That's what they were doing. And we've got to remember, these instructions, we often read things in the Bible and think, oh, okay, this is what we got to do to get in, right? But these instructions from Jesus are not instructions on how to win God's grace, right? Because God's grace is freely given to all. There's no winning it. These instructions are about modeling God's kingdom for the rest of the world. They're about living a life so strange, it only makes sense if God exists. That's what these instructions from Jesus are about. Not how to get in, but how to stand out. So the challenge for us then is to figure out, what does that look like now in the 21st century? You know, we don't have Roman soldiers coming up to us forcing us to walk a mile and then we can say, no, I'll walk too. It's a different world. We got to figure this out. Reverend Frost in the book says, if we're trying to live questionable lives, then cutting the lawn, saying hi to the neighbors, washing the car, walking the dog, driving to work, that's hardly intriguing, right? Even, he makes the point, you know, good church-going Christians doing nice things, that's not really surprising. And he says, don't stop doing those things, obviously, but what are ways we can be a little bit more intriguing to the rest of the world? So this is our homework. Besides reading the first chapter of the book, if you haven't already, think about the rhythms of your life. Look at your calendar. Look at the week ahead. What do you do every day? What are your habits? And what of those things that you do are motivated by your faith? Besides showing up here on a Sunday, what do you do throughout the week because you believe Christ is alive? And what are some things that maybe have piqued some curiosity from folks? I'm sure we all have a couple, right? That we've been questioned about at one point in our lives. But then think about, you know, how can we be a little more questionable each day? So it's the last Sunday of February, of April. And April, of course, is National Poetry Month. So I have one last chance to get a little poetry in. Wendell Berry, fantastic poet and farmer, has a suggestion for us on how to do this, how to be questionable every day. And it comes from a poem of his that's much longer, but it's so good. If you like poetry, look up The Mad Farmer Liberation Front by Wendell Berry. He says, "So friends, do something every day that won't compute. Every day, do something that won't compute. Love the Lord, love the world, work for nothing, take all that you have and be poor. Love someone who does not deserve it. Practice resurrection." May we be questionable this week as we go now to practice and live and proclaim the resurrection by the way we live each day.